Can you tell us the story of Kevin Sullivan, Yukihiro Kanemura, and the Iron Spike, please? I used to get tapes of Smoky Mountain Wrestling sent to me every month from a friend in Tennessee, and that incident really sticks in my mind as one of the most unexpected and gory things I've ever seen.
Kanemura and Kevin Sullivan. And here's the story. It was unexpectedly gory for me, too. What happened was, at the time, the Wing, W-I-N-G promotion, in Japan, Victor Quinones was involved, who obviously was heavily involved in the Puerto Rican promotion for so long. And some of their talent was coming over to work in the States. And Kevin was working with them and had known Victor from Puerto Rico and Florida for ages and eons. And basically, Kevin had called me and said, hey, these guys, the promotion is sending them over to work in the States to get footage, and they'd be glad to do your TV. And no trans, they're already here. And it gave us fresh faces. And it was Bill DeMott, who was Crash the Terminator back then, who was one of their top guys, and also Miguel Perez Jr., who went on to become one of the Bariquas in the WWE, or F at that point in time. And Yukihiro Kanemura, and I think that somebody else came also, I'm trying to think. And at the time, we had been doing the deal where Kevin had the golden spike, and he had been revealed as the master, the guy who had this following, this cult following of the Night Stalker, Brian Clark, who later became Adam Bomb, and several other weird characters, right, in Smoky Mountain. He had been revealed that the master was Kevin Sullivan, who was pulling the strings, and he had used the golden spike on Brian Lee, and Brian had just bled like a stuck hog, and we put a big red X over the screen, made it look even more gory than it was. And
so,
Kevin,
so what was the golden spike? Was it something like brass knucks?
It was a wooden spike.
Oh.
It was a piece of wood that was kind of like a stake, and he would stab people with it. And at the time, you know, since we didn't do anything else like that, you know, Kevin was kind of like our hardcore thing, and I knock ECW and et cetera. But we, you know, at the same time, we kept it under control until the Kanemura episode. And Kevin had told me, he said, you know, brother, he said, the kid Kanemura, he'll really get the spike over because he blades his arm. I said, what? Because this was not common practice at that point in time. I, you know, Abyss was not around at that point, and you know, maybe the original Sheik, because he wore his forehead out, would blade his arm, but nobody else did that type of thing. And I said, are you sure? He said, yeah. I said, why? We don't want to go too far. No, but he'll get some juice from the arm. I'll, you know, so okay, fine, all right. Trying to get Kevin over as this psychopathic, dangerous motherfucker, sort of like real life. And so anyway, they have the match, and Kevin attacks him, and he spikes him, and the kid blades his arm, his bicep, but the thing is, it didn't really bleed. And I'm looking, I'm like, this is kind of anticlimactic. And we're at a small high school gym somewhere, and the fans didn't really react in horror or terror because A, they didn't have any emotional attachment invested in this young Japanese kid that they'd never seen before and wasn't ever going to see again. We're in a, you know, somewhere in the, you know, wilds of Virginia. And secondly, because there wasn't a lot of blood. I mean, Brian Lee had bladed his head and bled like a stuck hog, and he wasn't hurt or anything, obviously, but it was a ton of blood, you know, on an earlier program. But this arm wasn't really bleeding that much. And, you know, you saw Kevin kind of working on it, and I think the kid even did it another time or two, and there wasn't a lot of blood, and people weren't going crazy. But then as we got a close-up, I said, oh, my Jesus Christ, Lord, and have mercy. If for some reason, he bladed in a place on his arm that he cut the fat, and it was a huge, giant gash. It just wasn't bleeding, and it led. And I said, get off of that. We didn't get any more close-ups of it. And that's another thing. When we aired it, we did the red X over it for a variety of reasons. But when he came back in the back, I'm like, oh, my God, because it was a giant slice in his arm, and it was sickening to look at, and it wasn't really bleeding that once again that much, but it was just deep and wide. And I'm like, fuck, this guy's got to go get sewed up, right? So they took him to the hospital, and you can imagine the consternation when here comes a Puerto Rican guy bringing in a Japanese wrestler with an arm gashed open, was still wearing his tights, who didn't speak any English, into a little small town hospital in Western Virginia. And the the legend of it has grown ever since. It you know, it got Kevin Spike over a little bit and made him, you know, somewhat of a madman, but it wasn't like one of the, you know, proudest moments that we ever had, and definitely was something that we stayed away from then on. And to this day, when I see, and I love Abyss as a person, but, you know, when I see the thumbtacks and cutting the arms, and he's not the only one that does it. They did it up in ECW, and they've done it in CZW and all that shit. No, nobody, anytime that I can think of, and if somebody points it out, I'll admit it, but I don't believe that I've ever been responsible for anybody cutting any portion of their body except for their forehead as God intended it, you know, ever again in anything that I was responsible for. That was enough for me.
Yeah, that sounds really vicious. The look on my face was
just the kid did not mind it either. He's like, oh, was it okay? You know, more should I done? No, don't do any more.
Just slice right into the bicep. That'll be good.
Yeah, it was. Oh God,
cut off the arm. You know, yeah. Why not? Let's get extreme up in here. Goodness gracious. All right.
Get extreme up in
here. Moving on to
gangsta on me now?
Oh, of course. All the time. That's who I am.